Father, we thank you because we are gathered in your love.
Baba dupe lowo nitori pe a pejo ko ninu ife yin.
We know that your hand of love is beneath us, above us, and on our side.
Amo ipe owo ife yin be lori wa, nbe nisale wa, nbe legbe wa.
We are surrounded by your love.
Ife yin loyi wa.
You plan for us in your love.
E ti gbero fun wa ninu ife
yin. You lead us in your love.
E to wa ninu ife
yin. You teach us in your love.
E ko wa ninu ife yin.
We are praying that we'll get into the experience of that love even more and more today in Jesus' name.
Agbadura ipe ki e mu awo inu iriri
We pray that these teachings you are giving us on marriage and the family and the rearing of children and living together will be of benefit to every one of us in Jesus' name. Give everyone the heart to submit to your word. In Jesus' name we pray. As most of us know, we have been on the studies on marriage and the family from the 1st of July, the 1st of this month.
Gẹ́gẹ́ bí ọ̀pọ̀lọpọ̀ nínú wa ti mọ̀, a ti wà nínú ẹ̀kọ́ nípa ìgbéyàwó láti ọjọ́ kìíní oṣù keje ti a wà yìí.
As we announced before, we were planning that we will be handling the questions on marriage just for this month of July.
Gẹ́gẹ́ bí a ti ṣe ìfilọ̀ tẹ́lẹ̀.
But as we checked up in the question boxes, we find that so many questions have come in on marriage and the family. And we see that it's difficult for us to say everything God wants us to say during the month of July. So we have already planned now that we will continue with this subject of marriage and family for all the Sundays of August. Don't you think that's a good idea? You see, we're slowly moving on because these are areas where we cannot be in a hurry. I had a disappointing experience some years ago. You know, that time I just bought a new car. And because of the subject I studied at school, we are taught to analyze and to, you know, do things in proper way. When you study mathematics, you think that you are able to handle any problem. Because of my years of study, I have a way of remembering facts and remembering ideas. And so I got the car and I got the manual and then I got all the, you know, this booklet that shows you the road signs when you want to take a test on driving. And I studied that book and I learned driving very fast. And I was asking my teacher, the person instructing me on driving, when are we going to finish and going for the test? He said it's not as fast as that. I said, I'm sure I will pass. Book me in. And you know, because I gave him pressure, he booked me in and I went for the test. The policeman sat me down and questioned me on the theory, and you know, I just gave him answers there in the head. He said, all right, take your key and get into the car for practical. No, I got in there, put in the key in the ignition, and you know, pushed what I should push, pull what I should pull, and then I started the car and I started moving. I almost broke the leg of the policeman. He said, stop. Then we got back to the station. He said, go and practice, you have failed. You know you are driving when you are getting married. And you marry this man and you have the key in your hand. And the Bible passages are there. And you tell the teacher and the preacher, hurry up, let's finish this thing in time. You say, no, it's not like that. Go slowly. You say, let me go for the test. Now you go for the test and you almost break the leg of your wife. Ruin your home. Because you are not patient enough. So that's why we are going just step by step, and we know at last we are going to get to the end. Tonight this afternoon, I'm talking on the journey into marriage. You know, when you are going on a journey, you're looking for milestones by the side of the road. These milestones help you to know how near the end of the journey you are. And in our journey on marriage today, I'm giving you some milestones to watch on the side of the road. These are the milestones. The perception or the purpose of marriage. A partner in marriage. The preparation for marriage. The price for marriage. And the pattern for marriage and wedding. We've covered some of these areas in our journey as we have started from the 1st of July. And yet, as review, I will just remind you of what we have studied already. One, the perception of the purpose of marriage. You know that there is a purpose why we do whatever we do. Understanding, analyzing, and accepting that purpose will give meaning to your marriage. These are the reasons we get married. One, it's for procreation. Two, it's for pleasure. Three, it's for purity. Four, it's for partnership. And five, it's for the provision of care, love, and security, and the supply of need in the home. When God created Adam and Eve, He blessed them. He told them to multiply and fill up the earth. That's the purpose of procreation. When Paul the Apostle was writing to the Christians, the Hebrew Christians, he told them that marriage is honorable in all and they bear undefiled. He told the Corinthian Christians that the wife does not have her body for herself, it belongs to the husband. And the husband does not have his body for himself, it's for the wife. That's for pleasure, for enjoyment in the marriage. And as Solomon the king was writing to the people of his day, he told them, Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice of the wife of your youth.
Bi Solomon bi o si se nko we si awon eni akoko re o wi pe je ki e ma yo pelu igba ewe re si ma yo pelu aya igba ewe re.
So that means marriage is for procreation, it's for pleasure.
Eyi ni pe igbeyawo o wa fun iseda ati fun igbadun.
You've come across this verse before where Paul the apostle by the Spirit told the Corinthian Christians to avoid fornication. Let every woman have her own husband, and let every man have his own wife. That's for purity.
O ti se alabapa die se iwe mo yi tele ti Paul ko si awon onigbagbo ni Corinth nipa se mi si emi mo wi pe ki o ma ba si agbere ki olukuluko okunrin ko ni aya ti re ki olukuluko obirin si ni oko ti re pelu.
Jesus God looked at Adam when he was created.
Olorun wo Adamu nigba ti a da tan.
And as he saw him in a situation,
bi o si ti ri ni ipo kan,
then he gave us a statement.
O fun wa ni oro kan.
And that statement is still true and valid today.
Otito si ni gbolohun to si wa titi doni.
What's the statement?
Kini gbolohun na?
It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him and help meet for him.
Ko dara ki okunrin na ki o ma da wa ni onikan emi o se oluranlowo ti o dabi re fun.
Marriage is to solve the problem of loneliness.
Igbeyawo wa lati yanju idawa nikan.
And therefore marriage is for the purpose of partnership or companionship.
Nitori na igbeyawo o wa fun ibakegbe ati ajorinpo.
As Paul was writing to Timothy, a preacher, a teacher and a pastor over a church, he said, if any does not provide for his own house, it's worse than an infidel. He has denied the faith.
Gẹ́gẹ́ bí Paul apostle bí ó ṣe kọ̀wé sí Timothy tí ṣe oníwàásù olùkọ́ àti olùṣọ́ àgùntàn ó wí pé bí ẹnikẹ́ni kò bá pèsè fún ilé rẹ̀ ó burú ju aláìgbàgbọ́ lọ.
Writing to the Ephesians, he said that but the husband will nourish the wife, cherish the wife, care for the wife, protect the wife, and do everything that the wife will need for satisfaction in life.
Nigbati o nko we si awon ijo ni Corinth wi pe oko yo ma pese fun aya re, yo ma toju re, yo ma ke, yo ma sike re, yo ma bojuto, yo ma dabobo, yo si ma pese gbogbo ti o ba nilo ninu aye fun.
So then if you are married, you ought to examine your marriage. Is it fulfilling the God intended purpose?
Nitori na bi o ba ti se igbeyawo ni lati tun yiri igbeyawo re wo wi pe nje o mu eredi ti Olorun fi gbe kale se bi.
You know there was somebody who went to school.
Eni kan wa ti o lo si ile iwe.
It's a Bible college.
Ni ile eko bibeli ni.
And then he refused to go for some lectures.
O si ko lati lo fun awon eko kan.
And the lecturers wrote to this fellow a note and they said, now will you come and report in the office and tell us why you are not attending class.
Oluko si wa ko iwe si wi pe ejo a n fe ki o farahan ni odo wa eredi re ki o wa so fun eredi re ti o ki bi wa si kilasi.
You know this young man said, I prayed and it's the will of God for me to attend this school, but I want to tell you I also prayed and the Lord does not want me to attend some of the classes like Greek, like Hebrew, like biblical interpretation. The Lord doesn't want me to attend that, but I'm sure the Lord wants me to attend the college.
O si da mi loju pe Olorun lo ni kin wa nigba ti mo si wa pelu mo tun ri pe Olorun ko fe kin wa si awon kilasi kankan bi elei ti a tin ko eko nipa ede Hebrew, ede Greek ati bi a se ntumo oro Bibeli ati
awon. They tried to convince him to show up in these other classes. He said, no, the Lord doesn't want me to.
Won gbiyanju lati fe fun ni idaniloju nipa awon kan ti won ko wi pe Olorun fe ki o wa si kilasi won yo ni rara.
But they asked him, but you are sure God wants you to be in this college?
Won tun be lo re pe awon fo ni idaniloju pe Olorun fe ki o wa si college.
Oh yes, I prayed and God told me this is the college you must attend.
Oni be ni mo gbadura ile isin ni college ti Olorun ti Olorun wi pe kin lo.
And you are sure he doesn't want you to attend the difficult areas of the subject? As oh yes, he doesn't want me to attend.
A o si da loju pe ko fe ki o la awon ibi to le ninu awon eko na jabi oni be ni ko fe.
The faculty wrote a letter to him and told him, sir, we have also prayed and God doesn't want you to take us in this college.
Awon igbimo ile eko na won joko won gbi won wa ko letter si wi pe awa pelu ati gbadura Olorun
I'm telling you that because we pray to get married, to know the will of God, but once you accept that will of God, you accept everything that goes with that will of God. So you don't go to pray, should I have children or not? That's already part of the puzzle. That's part of the will of God. Should I give myself to my husband? Should I give myself to my wife. You don't need to pray about that part. That is part and parcel of the will of God in
marriage.
Should I leave other women alone, getting into their lives, discussing with them, getting intimate with them? You don't need to pray about that. When you accepted the will of God in marriage, you also accepted the purity of marriage and all that the marriage will entail.
Se mo ni lati fi okunrin mi sile kin si fi obirin mi sile ko je pe oko mi tabi aya mi nikan ni ma ba lopo e pe ko ni lo ma lo sita mo be ni ara nkan to nbe ninu igbeyawo ni o wa fun iwa mi ma ti wa funfun.
And I'm sure you are not praying, should I give my wife money for food? That's part of the deal.
Mo si mo pe o ko ni ma gbadura pe Olorun se kin fun yawo mi lowo nje o je ara ihun to nbe ninu.
Should I care for her, talk with her, love her, protect her, secure her in life? That's part of the whole deal. You have accepted the will of God in that marriage. You also accept the responsibility to provide for that wife.
Shake ma bojuto ki ma toju re ki ma dabobo ki ma se kere ki feran re be ni ara nkan ti ara ojuse to nbe ninu igbeyawo ni nigba ti o ba ti gba ife olorun ninu igbeyawo wa gba ojuse to nbe ninu re pelu re.
You know, it will be surprising, you bought a car and you didn't also get the key along with it. You are praying whether to get the key or not.
O mo pe yo ya ni lenu bi o ba wu pe o ra moto sugbon ti o ku gba kokoro re o wa ni ohun gbadura boya ki o lo gba tabi.
You rented a house and you know it's the will of God to be in that house, but you are praying, shall I receive all the keys to the rooms or not?
O lo ya ile gbe leyin ti o sanwo ile tan o ko gba kokoro wa be si nbere bi pe o wa be si npe mo fe lo gbadura boya ki nsule na tabi ki ma ma sunbe.
I'm sure you get the point. If you don't want to have children, why get into marriage?
O da mi loju pe nkan ti mo so yi o ti o ko ba fe bimo kilode ti o fe se igbeyawo.
If you don't want to submit yourself in the human family relationship between husband and wife, why did you get married?
Bi o ko ba fe jo wa ara re we le gege bi idapo to nbe laarin oko si aya kilode ti o fe wonu igbeyawo.
Evaluate your marriage.
Iwo ye igbeyawo.
In terms of fulfilling each of these points we have mentioned,
ninu ati mu gbogbo awon koko won ti ati daruko won,
and it is possible you have not fulfilled God's intended purpose, but you see you can pray and God will help you to fulfill the divine intention for your marriage.
O se se ki o ma ti mu eredi ti Olorun fi gbe igbeyawo kale se ninu igbeyawo re, sugbon bi o ba gbadura yo ran lowo lati mu awon eredi won.
And as you are getting married, also ask yourself, this individual I want to marry, will he be able to fulfill all these various purposes of God in marriage?
Bi o ba si tin fe se igbeyawo si lati be lowo ara re, nje eni ti mo n fe fe yo mu awon ete Olorun se ninu igbeyawo yi?
You pray to know the will of God.
O n gbadura lati mo ife Olorun.
I told you in the first teaching we had, the 1st of July,
mo so fun yin ninu eko akoko ti a ni ninu ojo kini osu keje,
that to be hungry is natural for every normal human being.
Ipe ki ebi ma pa eniyan, nkan ti o dara fun eniyan ni.
To be thirsty is natural for any normal human being. And to feel physically attracted to other people is natural and normal. It's not abnormal. And God puts the desire in the heart of man, in the heart of a woman, to get settled and get married. But you see, we must emphasize that we don't build marriage on the sand of physical emotions or emotional feeling, physical look and physical attraction.
Don't
build such a wonderful home and such a great subject of marriage on marital material status, social status, because you see these things don't last.
A ki gbe ipile igbeyawo eni lori awon iko ti eniyan je ninu aye tabi bi enikan se ri abi bi o se wa.
When God is leading you as a believer, he will lead you to somebody just like you.
Nigba ti Olorun ba n dari re ninu igbeyawo, yo dari re si odo enikan to je pe o dabi iwo gan.
You know, even in the animal kingdom, an animal is led to another animal just like that animal.
Ninu ijoba eranko papa, awon eranko odo elegbe won gege bi ti won na ni won lo.
And so if you are a believer, God will lead you to a believer just like you for a life partner.
Nítorí náà bí ó bá jẹ́ onígbàgbọ́, Ọlọ́run yóò darí rẹ sí ọ̀dọ̀ onígbàgbọ́ tó dàbí rẹ gan
fún ẹni. Someone with like precious faith.
Ẹni tó ní ìgbàgbọ́ bíi tirẹ gan.
With like values in life, who love the Lord Jesus Christ the same way you love Jesus Christ.
Ẹni tó mọyì nǹkan bí ìwọ pẹ̀lú ti mọyì rẹ, tí ó fẹ́ràn Kristi, tí ó sì gbé Kristi lárugẹ bí ìwọ ti gbé.
Someone with similar life goals, interests, ambitions, directions in life.
Ẹni tó ní irú ìlépa àti ìgbòkègbodò kan náà nínú ayé gẹ́gẹ́ bí ìwọ ti ní.
Somebody whose spiritual commitments are as wide and as deep and as far reaching as your own commitments to Christ are.
Ẹni tó jẹ́ pé ìfara ẹni jì rẹ̀ tí ó gbòòrò tí ó ga tí ó sì fẹ̀ gẹ́gẹ́ bí tirẹ̀ ti fẹ̀ nínú Kristi.
As a believer, God will lead you to someone with whom you can build a deep, profound and meaningful companionship and relationship in your life.
Gẹ́gẹ́ bí onígbàgbọ́, Ọlọ́run yóò darí rẹ sí ọ̀dọ̀ ẹni tó jẹ́ pé ẹ ó jọ fọwọ́sowọ́pọ̀ láti ṣe ìgbéyàwó tó lárinrin tó níyì tó sì lọ́wọ̀ tí ó sì níye lórí.
In many passages of the Bible,
nínú ọ̀pọ̀lọpọ̀ ẹsẹ̀ Bíbélì,
the Bible makes it very clear that light and darkness do not come together.
Bíbélì jẹ́ kó yé ni gbangba wípé ìmọ́lẹ̀ àti òkùnkùn kì í wá papọ̀.
And that God will never, listen to me, God will never lead a believer to marry an unbeliever.
Sì tẹ́tí sí mi, Ọlọ́run kò ní fi ìgbà kan rárá ẹ̀sùn onígbàgbọ́ pọ̀ mọ́ aláìgbàgbọ́.
Take that thing and swallow it.
Gba nǹkan yìí kí o sì gbé mi.
You know, we know how God acts.
A mọ bí Ọlọ́run ti ń ṣe.
We know the ways of God.
A mọ ọ̀nà Ọlọ́run.
Because the way of God is the Bible way, is the way of the word of God.
Nítorí pé ọ̀nà Ọlọ́run ni ọ̀nà ti Bíbélì, ọ̀nà ọ̀rọ̀ Ọlọ́run.
And you know, I'm yet to understand.
Ó sì kò tí yé mi tó.
Why a person.
Èrèdí rẹ̀.
Who has a qualified architect.
Tí ẹni tí ó ní ẹni tó mọ bí a ti ń yà
wọ. And this architect is planning the building of your house.
Ayàwòrán ilé yóò sì ń gbèrò ilé kíkọ́ rẹ̀.
And he's spending all his time, all his attention, all his effort, all his knowledge on planning to build a house for you.
Ó sì ń lo gbogbo àkókò rẹ̀, gbogbo ipá rẹ̀, gbogbo okun rẹ̀, gbogbo ìgbèrò rẹ̀ sínú àtikọ́lé kan fún ọ.
This expert architect they are calling for all over the world is putting all his attention on drawing your own house, your pattern for you.
Ẹni tó jẹ́ pé ó mọ àwòrán ilé yà, tó jẹ́ pé gbogbo àgbáyé ni ó ń pè láti wá ràn wọ́n lọ́wọ́ nípa ilé wọn. Òun náà ló ń gbèrò tirẹ̀ fún
ọ. You go to a fake architect somewhere with no training, with no understanding to build a house on the sand for you, a house that will be blown away in the storms of life.
O wa lo sodo alumo ayaworan ile kan ni ibi kan wi pe ki o wa yaworan ile fun ele to je ko yo ba oni ile je yo si wo ile re pale.
In heaven there is a drawing board.
Ni orun pako ti a yaworan.
And the God of heaven, the great architect, is planning your marriage for you.
Olorun orun ayaworan la to ga julo o si ya o n gbero yawo.
And he's looking all over the world for the unique individual that will fit into your life.
O si wo kakiri aye, o n wa enikan soso eleyi ti yo ba igbesi aye re mu.
And he wants to give you somebody that will fit into your life perfectly. And I'm yet to understand why many people are running away from the plan of the architect of heaven and they're going about to quack architects in the world to ruin their lives for them. What a pity.
O si fe fun oni enikan to je pe yo ba igbesi aye re mu on gugu yo si ma lo dede sugbon o ya o yin ya mi lenu eredi re ti awon eyan ton fin lo kakiri ton lo n ba awon alumo ayaworan kakiri ninu aye lati ran won lowo nipa igbeyawo won ti won yo si so igbeyawo won dedo arin.
Moses the man of God emphasized it in Deuteronomy chapter 7 verses 1 to 4.
Moses ni Olorun o tenu mo ni Deuteronomy orikeje lati ese ikini de.
He told Israel,
o so fun awon Israeli,
you must not forget this.
E ko gbodo gbagbe eleyi.
Never get into any marriage covenant with the people who are unbelievers or the idol worshippers.
Ma se ba awon aborisa awon alaigbagbo dana.
In Joshua chapter 23 verses 10 to 13, Joshua emphasized it upon the people again. Never will you make any approach to unbelieving people around us to have any marriage covenant with them.
Bákan náà ni Joshua tún tẹnu mọ́ fún àwọn ọmọ Israẹli nínú ìwé Joshua orí 23 ẹsẹ̀ 10:17 wípé ẹ kò gbọ́dọ̀ fi ìgbà kan ó jẹ́ èèwọ̀ fún yín wípé ẹ kò gbọ́dọ̀ bá àwọn aláìgbàgbọ́ dànù, ẹ kò gbọ́dọ̀ fẹ́ ọmọ wọn.
And the New Testament repeats it.
Májẹ̀mú titun tún sọ.
Emphasizes it.
Ó tún tẹnu mọ́.
And he puts the nail on the right point in your life saying, Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers.
O si fi isoti o ye o si fi isosi ibi to ye gan ninu igbese aye re o si wi pe ma se fi adogba da po pelu awon alaigbagbo.
In 2 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 14, let's read it together.
Ninu we Corinthians ko jori kefa ese ikerin la je ki aka.
Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers.
E ma se fi idogba da po pelu awon alaigbagbo.
I want you to understand something.
Mo fe ki kankan yi o.
I remember when we were very young.
Mo ran ti igba ti a wa ni ewe.
That you know, mother will be cooking food.
Iya wa yo ma se onje.
And you know, I come from an area where if you don't take pounded yam every day, you must be a poor family.
E mo si wa lati bi to je pe to ki ba ma jeyan lojojumo, a je pe talaka ni eni ebi yin.
And so for people not to think you are poor, you just have to manage and eat pounded yam every night.
Nitori na ki awon eyan ma ba lero wi pe talaka ni wa sa ma tiraka wa ma gbianju lati ma jeyan la lale.
You say that may account for the reason why this man is heavyweight, maybe.
Wa ni boya iredi re ni to je pe okunrin fi wuwo nle.
And you see, every time we add pounded yam, but listen to me, while they're still making ready, we'll be asking for mommy, give us yam, give us yam, and they'll say no. The best is yet to come. But we were such in a hurry, we little children. You know, when the Lord said, be not unequally yoked together with some believers, you know the reason he's saying that? There is a believer that God has with him that he's bringing your way, and he's saying, don't bother yourself, we'll do some believers in your office. I'm bringing something, you'll be surprised when I bring it. Don't be in a hurry to fill your belly with yam, because pounded yam is coming. That's what he's saying.
Ma se kanju lati kun ikun re pelu isu lasan ele to dara julo ti.
Be ye not unequally yoked together with some believers. For what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion has light with darkness? Now the Bible is, you know, so full as to the reasons why we must not marry unbelievers as believers. You know, I don't have the time to read all the references to you, but I'll just tell you those references. I'm giving you 14 reasons, 10 and 4, why a believer cannot, will not, it's impossible for him, impracticable for him, unreasonable for him to go and marry an unbeliever.
Mo so eredi merin la fun o mewa pelu merin bako ti eredi re to fi je ewo to fi je nkan ti onigbagbo ko gbodo se to fi je pe nkan ti onigbagbo ko gbodo dawole ni pe oun fe alaigbagbo.
You see, number one, the believer walks by faith, the unbeliever walks by sight. You cannot walk together.
Ikini onigbagbo rin nipa igbagbo sugbon alaigbagbo rin nipa oun to foju ri e ko le jorin.
To the unbeliever, your faith walk is an unreasonable walk. To the believer, the sight walk is a limited work, and they don't go together.
Loju ala loju ala igbagbo ririn nipa igbagbo re o je eleyi ti ko mo gbadan ni sugbon loju ti re ririn nipa ohun to foju ri re eleyi to dara ni.
That's in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 7. We walk by faith, we do not walk by sight.
Ile wa ninu Corinthians keje ori karun ese ikeje awarin nipa igbagbo ki se nipa iriri.
And in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 18, while we look not at things which are seen, but we look at things which are not seen, because the things which are seen are temporal or temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal.
Bakana ni nitori pe ako won kan ti ako won ti ti an ri bi ko se on ti ako ri nitori on ti an ri.
So you see, if you marry an unbeliever, you are walking by faith and he's walking, and he is walking by sight, and you are walking in different directions, the home will break. Number two, the believer's complete and total allegiance to God. The unbeliever has a complete and total allegiance to the world, and they can't go together. The unbeliever
is committed to his natural family, but the believer is committed to the family of God in heaven and on earth. They are not together.
Aláìgbàgbọ́ ó ti fi ara rẹ̀ mọ́ àwọn ẹbí rẹ̀ nípa ti ara nínú ayé, ṣùgbọ́n onígbàgbọ́ ó ti fi ara rẹ̀ mọ́ ẹbí Ọlọ́run àti ẹbí tí ń bẹ Ọlọ́run, àwọn méjèèjì kò lè rìn.
The unbeliever is covered and swallowed up with the traditions of the world. The believer is swallowed up by the word of God. They can't be together.
Àṣà ayé ó ti kó aláìgbàgbọ́ lẹ́rú, ó sì ti dé ní ìgbèkùn, ṣùgbọ́n onígbàgbọ́ ọ̀rọ̀ Ọlọ́run òun náà ló ń gbé inú rẹ̀, tó sì kún ìgbésí ayé rẹ̀, àwọn méjèèjì kò lè rìn pọ̀.
Do you remember when David was dancing before the Lord?
Ìjọ rántí ìgbà tí Dáfídì ń jó níwájú
Olúwa. Committed to the Lord.
Tó fi ara rẹ̀ jì
fún Olúwa. Rejoicing before the Lord.
Tó yọ̀ níwájú Olúwa.
What did the wife say?
Kíni ìyàwó rẹ̀ wí?
Did the wife come out and say, "Oh yes, let's rejoice together because the Lord is great"?
Ǹjẹ́ ìyàwó rẹ̀ jáde kí ó wá kí ó sì sọ fún mi pé bẹ́ẹ̀ ni, ẹ jẹ́ kí a jọjó, kí a máa yọ̀ níwájú Olúwa.
No, the wife leaned over the window and saw the husband dancing and said, "Why are you rejoicing so much like that, like a vain fellow, stupid fellow, rejoicing before God?" You see, their lines were not the same.
Rárá ìyàwó rẹ̀ yọjú lójú fèrèsé ni, nígbà tó sì rí ó wá, ó ní kí ló fà á, èrèdí rẹ̀ tí ó fi fi ara rẹ̀ wọlẹ̀, tó ní òun yọ̀ tó lè, tó sì tó sọ ara rẹ̀ di akúrí, tó sọ ara rẹ̀ di dìdìrín nígboro.
You remember when Job was suffering as a believer?
Ó rántí ìgbà tí Job ń jìyà gẹ́gẹ́ bí onígbàgbọ́.
And he was, you know, he will not sin with his mouth.
Kò sì ní fi ẹnu rẹ̀ dẹ́ṣẹ̀.
He will glorify God.
Yóò yin Ọlọ́run lógo.
But you know, the wife was not thinking in the same direction.
Mẹ́ ìyàwó rẹ̀ kò ronú bí òun ti ń ronú.
And the wife came and said, "Are you still holding on to your integrity?"
Ìyàwó rẹ̀ tún bá, ó tún tọ̀wọ́ ní aṣẹ́ orí òdodo rẹ̀ náà ló ìdúró lé.
Curse God and die and damn the consequence.
Wú Ọlọ́run kí o kú, kí o sì gba nǹkan tí ó bá tẹ̀ yín rẹ̀ wá.
You see, they were not thinking the same way.
Orí pé o ìrònú wọn ò jọ ṣọ̀kan.
One was committed to God and the other was committed to the world. Number 3, Proverbs 28 verse 1 tells me, "The wicked man, the sinner runneth while nobody is driving or pursuing him, but the righteous is as bold as a lion." The life of the unbeliever is ruled by fear. The life of the believer, of the believer, is ruled by faith. They are not together.
Ẹkẹta ni ìwé ìwòrí kejìdínlẹ́ ọgbọ̀n ẹsẹ̀ ìkíní. Èèyàn búburú ń sá nígbà tí ẹnìkan kò le, ṣùgbọ́n olódodo láyà bíi kìnìún. Ohun tó ń darí ìgbésí ayé aláìgbàgbọ́ òun náà ni ẹrù tí ó sì ti dé ní ìgbèkùn, ṣùgbọ́n ọ̀rọ̀ Ọlọ́run àti ìgboyà náà ni ó ń ṣe àkóso ìgbésí
ayé. Number 4, do you realize that believers and unbelievers have different sources of information? Whenever they want to take a decision.
Ẹ̀kẹrin, ǹjẹ́ o mọ̀ wípé àwọn onígbàgbọ́ àti aláìgbàgbọ́, wọ́n ní orísun ìtọ́yìn àti ibi tí wọ́n ti ń gba ìròyìn wọn nígbà tí wọ́n bá fẹ́ ṣe nǹkankan tàbí mú ìpinnu.
Here you are getting information from heaven when you want to take a decision, and here is this other unbeliever, that's your partner, and she wants to take, or he wants to take, information from the world, and there are two different sources.
Ìwọ ni gẹ́gẹ́ bí onígbàgbọ́, nígbà tó bá fẹ́ mú ìpinnu tàbí ṣe nǹkankan, wà á gba ìhìn láti ọ̀run lórí ohun lórí nǹkan náà, ṣùgbọ́n aláìgbàgbọ́ yìí ni tí ó ní òun fẹ́ òun nínú ayé ní tirẹ̀ ló ti ń gba ìhìn tirẹ̀.
Number 5, your pursuits are different, your ambitions are different, and therefore if a believer marries an unbeliever, the family will be torn apart.
Ẹ̀kárùn-ún, ìlépa ẹ̀yin méjèèjì ó yàtọ̀, ìlépa onígbàgbọ́ yàtọ̀, ìlépa aláìgbàgbọ́ yàtọ̀ síra wọn. Bí ẹ bá sì fi ara yín nínú ìgbéyàwó náà yóò tú ká.
What are we told in Luke chapter 11 verse 17?
Kí ni a sọ fún wa nínú ìwé Luke orí kọkànlá ẹsẹ̀ ìkẹtàdínlógún?
Luke chapter 11 verse 17.
Luke orí kọkànlá ẹsẹ̀ ìkẹtàdínlógún.
But he, knowing their thoughts, said unto them, "Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and a house divided against a house falleth."
Ṣùgbọ́n òun mọ èrò inú wọn, ó wí fún wọn pé gbogbo ìjọba tí ó ya ara rẹ̀ ní ipa, aṣọ di ahoro, ilé tí ó sì ya ara rẹ̀ ní ipa, awo.
So you see, when you marry an unbeliever, from the very beginning, there can't be any unity.
Nítorí náà, gẹ́gẹ́ tó bá lọ fẹ́ aláìgbàgbọ́ láti ìbẹ̀rẹ̀ wá ni kò ti ní sí ìṣọ̀kan.
He's opposed to you are opposed to her.
Ó lòdì sí òun náà, lòdì sí ọ.
And number 6, the unbeliever is another spirit.
Éfésù orí kejì ẹsẹ̀ ìkejì sọ nípa ẹ̀mí tó ń gbé inú àwọn ọmọ aláìgbọràn, eléyìí kì í ṣe ẹ̀mí mímọ́ Ọlọ́run.
It says the people of the world are led and controlled and directed by the prince of the power of the air. That's bad.
Ó wí pé àwọn ènìyàn inú ayé, àwọn tó ń jẹ́ aláìgbàgbọ́, ẹ̀mí búburú tó ń ṣiṣẹ́ ní ojú ọ̀run nínú àwọn sánmọ̀, òun náà ló ń gbé inú wọn, eléyìí burú jọjọ.
What does it say of the believer?
Kí ló sọ nípa ti onígbàgbọ́?
Know ye not that you are the temple of the Holy Ghost which is in you, and you are not your own?
Ẹ̀yin kò mọ̀ wípé possessed, influenced, and controlled by different spirits, they cannot go together. Number 7, the Bible says in Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26, the unbeliever has a stony heart. And then he talks of the believer will give him a heart of flesh. You know, the Bible says to keep your heart with all diligence because out of it are the issues of life. And it says, a good man out of the good treasure of the heart will bring forth good things. An evil man, because of the evil treasure of the heart, will bring forth evil things. In Matthew 12:35. And if you marry a stony heart with a fleshly heart, you tell me there'll be problem. Listen to me, this is number 8. The Bible calls some believers goats. Stubborn and rebellious. That same Bible calls the believers sheep. Gentle and loving. Bring both of them together. The sheep will always be cheated by the goat. The goat will always oppress and always kick and always trouble the sheep. Marry them together. The sheep will be suffering. And the goat will be oppressing the other fellow. You know, the Bible calls the unbeliever a leopard. In Jeremiah chapter 13, verse 23. Leopard.
And
then the believers are called lambs. Jesus told Peter, feed my lambs. And you know, some years ago I went to the University of Ibadan. And the person who were visiting together said he wanted me to see this interesting place. I'd been there as a student for 3 years, but I didn't go to that area. It was called the zoo. And here these animals were, you know, in different places. And I saw some of those wild animals. The lion, the leopard, the bear, these various wild animals. And then there was no question at all why they didn't put the sheep in the same cage, the lamb in the same cage with the leopard.
It's
the same reason God doesn't want the unbelievers to marry believers and the believers to marry unbelievers. Put the leopard in the same cage as the lamb and there will be destruction, there will be wickedness, there will be
evil.
Do you know that the Bible calls sinners a generation of vipers, poisonous snakes? And then he calls the believers gentle, harmless doves. That's the 10th reason you can't marry an unbeliever as a believer. It's like putting a viper, a poisonous snake, a terrible sin, a dove, harmless and gentle, in the same cage. It's impossible. You harm yourself, you destroy yourself. Before Jesus went away, he called his disciples together. You know, he warned them very seriously. He said, you know, when you go into the world, it looks so gentle, like like you. They look so nice like you. But don't be deceived. I just tell you, they are wolf in chiefs in sheep's clothing. You are sheep and you're having on your right clothes a sheep with sheep's clothing, but these people in the world, they are wolves in sheep's clothing. The church goers may read
Psalms.
They may pray. And they may even say, I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. But you know, the anger betrays them. The fighting betrays them.
If you're
a believer, why are you behaving as a wolf? Destructive and deceptive. So if you're a sheep and if you're a child of God, don't get into the same cage with a wolf in sheep's clothing.
This
number 12, the unbelievers are dogs and swine. And the believers are children. And you know, when I read about the death of Jezebel in the Bible, and Jehu was saying, okay, go and see the body of that woman so and get her buried. Before they got there, the dogs are totally eating up the flesh. You know, if you put a police dog, I mean, these dogs that are really wild and they can devour anything, and you put a 2-day-old child in a place where the police dog is, you can tell what will happen. So if you're a child of God, a babe in Christ, if you are with the Lord and you go to marry an unbeliever, that's like putting a child with a police dog or a swine, you'll be destroyed.
Number 13,
the Bible calls unbelievers wild beasts in Ezekiel chapter 34. And it says that you are still sheep if you are a believer. Do you know the prayer of people in the Old Testament? Deliver us as you deliver a bird from the snare of the fowler. That means the unbelievers are just fowlers who are, you know, throwing out their snares to catch the bird. Those who wait upon the Lord, mounting up with wings as eagles, they want to catch them. But you, as a believer, you must run away from the snare of the fowler. Now, if you read the Bible at all, if you've listened to all this, you cannot allow the thought of marrying an unbeliever to cross your mind for a minute. Let's go on to the next milestone. The preparation for marriage. You've seen the will of God and you've determined the will of God. You've checked up. It's according to the promise of God. It's according to the purpose you have for life. And you have peace of heart concerning this will of God you have chosen. And you have also sought the pastor's counseling concerning it. What's the next step for you to take? Let's understand that the believers follow the principle of parental respect. Now, this sister you want to get married to is coming from a home. The brother you want to get married to is coming from a home. And the Bible says we respect, we honor our parents. So that our days may be long on the earth that God has given us. If there is any time to respect and honor our parents, it should be the time we want to get married. While the decision is yours as to who you marry, it should be with parental approval. That means we're was seeking the parents' consent. Now you know, sometimes you tell them. And you know, they've been waiting for a long time to hear you say that. I'm sure you know how to tell your mother, to tell your father. Now you don't come home and then you say, "Mommy, well, at last I want to get to this difficult yoke they call marriage."
A man
came to talk to me. And well, I'm considering it. If you talk like that, your mother will think that something is wrong. Your father will think something is wrong. Be happy about it. It's a good thing you want to get married. Call your mother in a good tone.
And
say, "Mommy, I have a story to tell. The question you have been asking me from such and such a year now, sit down, let's talk about it. Now I've seen the person I want to marry. From which stage?" Don't answer. Say, "Listen to me first. Be patient. I'll tell you everything." Because if you answer immediately from Anambra State, from Ondo State, from Ogun State, from Ijebu, Egba land, we'll say, "Don't talk about it." So, get her rejoicing first. Tell her this is wonderful. That, well, this is the best I can have ever in life. God has been very good to me. I've got more than I bargained for. This is just fantastic. Who is the person? Say, "I want to sing first." And while your mother is rejoicing, say that, "Well, do you know this beautiful person I'm talking about is from Ijebula?" Because she has been rejoicing, she will not be able to stop rejoicing quickly. So don't tell them first it's Ijebu or Egba or from Anambra or Igbo or Hausa. Just let them rejoice first you've got the person. If you talk in the proper way to your parents, they will agree. After all, you are the person getting married. But there are times they will say, "No, you can't do that." Let me tell you the reason why they say you can't do that. They have heard a lot of stories that so and so married from that area and it was very bad. You remember your cousin? That's why he had marriage problem. He married from such and such a place and it never worked. And your parents have decided that it cannot work. Don't argue with them. Go and talk to God about it. Proverbs chapter 21 verse 1. What does it say? It talks about the heart of your father, the heart of your mother. Your father is a king in his own house. Your mother is a queen in her own house. This verse is talking about them. In Proverbs 21 verse 1. The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord as the rivers of water. He turneth it whithersoever he will. And so even though your mother may resist at first, or your father may reject at first, take it to God in prayer. It will be done. Moses was surprised when he came before Pharaoh and said, "Pharaoh, God has revealed his perfect will. Let my people go." When he finished, Pharaoh said, "Who is that God? I don't know him. Don't talk to me about that."
Moses
Moses didn't argue, he went back to God. Go back to God when there is a difficulty. You know, eventually, as the days went by, the magicians were calling their king. They were calling Pharaoh. They said, Pharaoh, this is the finger of God. Let the people go. He still rejected, and Moses and Aaron kept praying. Don't look for an alternative when there is difficulty. Stick to the will of God. Eventually, Pharaoh called Moses and Aaron. He said, okay, you can go, but you tell me, who are the people going? And he said, everybody said, no, you men go, but leave your wives behind. Leave the children behind. They said, no, we can't do that. Sometimes your parents will strike a bargain after you have dragged it and you have prayed, and they'll say, okay, well, I will allow you this, but we can't allow this area. Keep on to what you're asking from God. Look at Exodus chapter 12. At last, Pharaoh had no alternative. Prayer changes things. Is that right? Prayer will change your mother. After all, prayer changed you. Prayer will change your father. After all, prayer changed you. And prayer will change anyone and everyone. In Exodus chapter 32, chapter 12 verse 31, and he called Moses and Aaron by night and said, rise up. At the beginning, he said, who is that God? I don't know that God. But look at what he's doing now. He called them and said, rise up, get you forth from among my people, both ye and the children of Israel, and go serve the Lord as ye have said.
O si pe Mose won Aroni le oru, o si wi pe e dide. Oun lo ti kokon fa akekori tele to wi pe oun ko ni je kun won lo, sugbon nisisin o wi pe e dide ki e jade lo kuro laarin awon eniyan mi ati eyin ati awon omo Israel.
Also take your flocks and your herds as ye have said, and be gone. Listen to what follows. This is Pharaoh, the same old man, but touched, changed, influenced by God. You see what he said? And bless me also.
Yes, Lord, you Lua be at we as a mua boyin at ati or where on ye be at we kies ikies in my law. You won't tell it also, and it's your jack alone for water and to jack alone for what you lock on. Also, we pay.
Keep on praying, the Lord will answer. He will touch the heart of our parents, and they will agree with the perfect will of God. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 35 and verse 36. Cast not away therefore your confidence, which has great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. Verse 38. Now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him.
Nítorí náà, ẹ má ṣe gbé ìgboyà yín sọnù, èyí tí ó ní èrè ńlá, nítorí ẹ̀yin kò lè ṣe aláìní sùúrù. Nítorí ìgbà tí ẹ̀yin bá ti ṣe ìfẹ́ Ọlọ́run tán, kí ẹ̀yin kí ó lè gba ìlérí náà, ẹsẹ̀ 32. Ṣùgbọ́n olódodo ni yóò yè nípa ìgbàgbọ́, ṣùgbọ́n bí ó bá fà sẹ́yìn, ọkàn mi kò ní inú dídùn sí i.
So keep on to the Lord.
Nítorí náà, faramọ́ Olúwa.
Keep on with the promises.
Tẹ̀síwájú pẹ̀lú àwọn ìlérí náà.
He will answer.
Yóò dáhùn.
He will do what we desire.
Yóò ṣe ohun tí à ń fẹ́.
Now we go to the next milepost, which is the price of marriage.
Nísinsìnyí, a lọ láti a tún lọ sí ibùsùn mìíràn tí í ṣe iye tí ìgbéyàwó náà ni.
You know, I'm surprised how some men, how they think.
Ó yà mí lẹ́nu bí àwọn ọkùnrin mìíràn ti ń ronú.
They can pay 10,000 naira for a car they are going to use for only 2, 3, 5 years, but they cannot give even, 100 naira for a wife they are going to marry for the whole of their life. If they get to the dealer of the vehicle and the dealer says, well, you know, vehicle has gone up now, and you know, when you came last month it was at this price, but now 2,000 naira has come on top of it, the man will say, but is this still available? If the dealer says it's available, he'll go and search everywhere to make sure that he pays for that car, only to serve him for 4 or 5 years. But if they want to get married and the parents of the lady, they are asking for maybe 100 naira more than what their friend paid when the friend was going to marry last year, you say, ah, why is it as much as that? After all, when my friend married last year, it was 100 naira less. Now our parents who are here, put cotton wool in your ear now, because I want to talk to the single people.
I don't want you to think
on what I'm going to say, but I'm talking to the young men and the young women to think on what I'm saying now. Now, you young men, you are the only one listening to me now. Have you interviewed Jacob?
And
say, Jacob, now, you know, I want to get married. And I heard that you got married. And how much dowry did you pay? And Jacob says, sit down, let me talk to you. 7 years of hard labor. That's the dowry I pay. You are thinking that the dowry they tell you to pay is too high, when Jacob spent 7 long hard years paying for wife. Aren't you grateful that our parents don't remember that Jacob paid for 7 years? And all they are asking for is just a token for you to show appreciation that they have been taking care of this lady up to this age. You know, David wanted to get married and was getting married to a daughter of Saul called Michal. And Saul said, okay, I'll give her to you. And David said, what dowry will I pay? And Saul said, I don't need your money, I'm a rich man. I don't need a house for you to build for me, I'm living in a palace. All I need from you is to go and catch 100 of Philistines. You caught one Goliath before, but I want you to get me 100 now. And kill them, those are my enemies. You do that, that's all the dowry you will pay.
The
young men are afraid of me now.
They
say, this man is talking of dowry like this. Then I will never get married. Cool now, I just told you that to make you afraid a little. It's not as difficult like that today. But what I'm saying is, don't expect that everything will go for free. They will ask you to pay dowry. They may ask you to bring 80 pieces of yam. I mean real yam, not the crony type, but real yam, 80. You better go to the farm and start searching.
Ole je pe 80 isu ni won ni ko lo mu wa ti ba te ba si pe ko mu 80 isu wa
After all, you are getting married. And don't you know that marriage has a price you must pay? And you know, let me tell you, from one area of this country to another, there are differences in their demand for dowry. In the north is different from the west here. In the west, what is demanded is different from the one in the east. But you see, the sister you want to marry will help you a lot. We'll talk to the, you know, we'll talk to the parents and say, well, this is all we have. Please do gently for us. And of course, they may tell you to bring some other things which, as a Christian, you don't want to give them. If you are in any confusion at all during the time of paying dowry, you know, that's why we have elderly sisters here. And in your zone, they'll be glad to help you, for these elderly sisters to go to your but to that family so they can talk to them. And if there's any area of counseling that you need in paying dowry, can I give this, can I not give that, your zonal leader, your area leaders, and the pastor here will be all willing and happy to help you out.
Now,
please, I know that our time is gone, but let me strike this note. Or do we say you listen to the first the cassette of the soul service? Shall we round up and then you go and listen to the cassette? I knew the answer you will give. I know you are waiting for something. Because you know I'm still going to talk on wedding. Just put on your shoes and get ready. You see, after you have paid the dowry, some people will wait and wait and wait and wait before the wedding. Let me show you one man that made that mistake. Very serious mistake. In Judges chapter 14. He paid the dowry. He did everything he ought to do. In Judges chapter 14. He had no counselor to counsel him. He had nobody, no advisor to advise him. And after paying the dowry and doing everything that ought to be done, he was still waiting. Judges chapter 14 and in verse 10. So his father went down unto the woman, and Samson made there a feast, for so used the young men to do. And then in verses 19 and 20, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon him, that he went down to Ashkelon and slew 30 men of them, and took their spoil, and gave change of raiments unto them, which expounded the riddle, and his anger was kindled, and he went up to his father's house. But Samson's wife was given to his companion, whom he had used for his friend.
Emi Oluwa si bale o si sokale lo si Ashkeloni o si pa gbon okunrin ninu won o si ko eru won o si fi iparo aso fun awon ti o ja alona ibinu re si ru o si goke lo si ile baba re won si fi obirin Samsoni fun okan ninu awon egbe re.
You know, he had paid the dowry. The wedding feast had been done. In fact, everything had been concluded. But he didn't take the wife immediately and just went back to his father's house. Chapter 15, verse 2. Later he came back and said, where is my wife? And he said, do you still love her? We thought you are just an eccentric fellow. You paid dowry and then you went. We didn't see you all that time. We've given her to another person.
Chapter 15 verse 2.
And her father said, I verily saw that thou hast utterly hated her, therefore I gave her to thy companion.
Baba ya resi wipe ni toto emi se bi iwo korira re patapata ni nitori na ni mo se fi fun egbe re.
If you are paid dowry, what are you waiting for?
Bi o ba ti dana ki lo tun duro,
wedding should follow immediately.
Iso yigi lo ye ko tele.
Now when we talk about wedding,
nigba ti a ba so nipa iso yigi,
members of Deeper Christian Life Ministry have, you know, some ideas that are not written in the Bible.
Awon omo egbe Deeper Life won ma ni ero miran ti ko si ninu Bibeli.
Listen to me very well, because after this meeting you are likely to go off and say, why was bro preaching like that?
Teti si mi daada nitori pe leyin waasu o se se ki o re koja nkan ti a so ko pe a ki lo de ti arakun wa nsoro bi.
And we don't have time. I just have a few minutes now to round up, and therefore we don't have time to read all the references.
A ko ni aye nisisin lati ma ka gbogbo awon ese bibeli ti ati ko sile
but fiti si mi. Wedding in the Bible, it appears in Genesis 29, it appears in Ruth chapter 4, it appears in Matthew chapter 22, Matthew chapter 25, and John chapter 2.
Oh, honey, no, Genesis ori kokandilogbon, Ruth ori kerin, Matthew ori kejilelogun, Matthew ori karundini ogbon, ati Johan ori keji.
Customs have changed.
Awon asa ti yipada.
Ideas about wedding have changed completely since Bible times.
Awon ero nipa rede o ti yato lati igba Bibeli.
Now you see, at the time of the Bible,
ni igba Bibeli,
it was the parents that arranged for the wedding.
Awon obi lo ma nseto arede awon omo won.
And it was always done at night. That's why Jacob did not know that it wasn't Rachel that was given to him. The wedding was done at night. And instead of giving him Rachel, they gave him
Leah.
It was when he woke up in the morning and said, the wedding of last night did not go well. What's your name? Are you not Leah? Laban, what have you done? He says, well, that's part of wedding at night. Take it. And the feast and the ceremony was performed at home in the house, not in the synagogue or temple or in the church. Wedding garments were sometimes provided by the invitees or for the invitees. And of course, there was a lot of eating and a lot of drinking. But you see, today we cannot lay down any rule. We cannot say you must have the wedding at 10 o'clock, at 12 o'clock, at 6 o'clock, or at night at 11 o'clock. We cannot say you must not have the wedding in the church because it was done at home in the Bible days.
You see,
some of these things depend on our environment, our background, or what we're used to. But even though we cannot give you rules and regulations, we can give you biblical principles to guide you in your planning of wedding. Now, these are principles I want you to think about before you pray. The wedding day is a rejoicing day. Therefore, the Bible says you can rejoice with your friends on the day of your wedding. That's in Isaiah chapter 62, verse 5, and John chapter 3, verse 29. But the Bible makes it clear in Psalm 2 verse 11 that you rejoice with trembling. In Psalm 19 verse 5 it says you rejoice as a man going to run a race. That is, the wedding day is not the end of the marriage, it's the beginning of the marriage. In Ecclesiastes it says, rejoice, O young man, but remember God will bring judgment if anything goes wrong. And Principle number three, you want to think about in your marriage, your wedding, spend. You have to spend on your wedding, but don't spend all you have.
Ilana keta ona ni pe ninu igbeyawo re oni lati nawo sugbon ma se na gbogbo ti oni.
There is no command in the Bible that you must feed all the people, everybody in town, but there's a commandment you must feed your wife, provide for your wife, and care for your wife. Don't put the money you ought to use to care for your wife on the people in one day. Don't feed them in one day and suffer for 1 year. Principle number four, don't start the foundation of your marriage, family, and home with borrowing. Number five, pray in faith, but plan with sense. Don't plan to spend the money you have not got. Don't plan big because you are comparing yourself with other people. Avoid pride, avoid vainglory, avoid vanity, and avoid
sure.
Avoid the useless traditions of men. Don't be bound by the unwritten laws of human society.
The
sizes of our clothes are different. The sizes of our shoes are different. Our incomes are also different.
Don't copy
other people. Cut your coat according to your size. Be modest in your dressing. Do all things to the glory of God. Be not conformed to this world. Now I'm ending up with Deuteronomy chapter 24. You know, when I read this in the Bible, I was laughing. I said, so this is in the Bible also? Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 5. You know, I pity people who don't read the Bible, who don't study the Bible. And on your marriage, on your wedding, on your family, you must study the Bible. Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 5. When a man has taken a new wife, that's where we are because we have now taught on wedding. When a man has taken a new wife, he shall not go out to war. Neither shall he be charged with any business, but he shall be free at home 1 year. And shall cheer up his wife with which he has taken. I mean, the Bible counts marriage so important that it says for an Israelite, when you get married for 1 whole year, it is just every morning you wake up, I love you. Every time is just to say how wonderful, how lucky I am to marry you. 1 whole year to be on leave because you have married. Let me tell you the reason why. You see, when two people come together, they need to make readjustments in living together. And they need all that length of time to readjust, to know one another, study one another, live together, adjust their lives together. And even though we are not advocating that you be on leave for the whole year today, but then the principle is still there. When you are married, stay together. together, pray together, love one another, plan your life together, readjust and start to live with another person, with this other person at the beginning of the marriage. You see, an Israelite will never borrow money to be able to have wedding. Because if he borrows money for the next 1 year, he's not working at all. How does he pay back? How does he take care of his family? In fact, he must make sure that all the money he's going to spend for the 1 year is on leave, when he's just loving his wife and living with his wife. That money is there. That's why you'll plan the wedding with care and with common sense.
You
The Bible is wonderful. And this is our Father's book. He has given it to us so that we can plan our lives in a way that we shall be happy all through our lives. I pray that this word we have listened to today will regulate our lives, will help our families. And as we continue all the Sundays of July and August, I believe that the Lord will put right everything in our homes in Jesus' name. It has been a wonderful time today. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord, thanking the Lord for what he has done, for what he has taught us, for what he has exposed to us in this world. God will